and welcome to this temple of the imagination. Allow me to introduce myself. My name, dear audience, is Louis de Rougemont. Are you ready to be astonished?
Yes! Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. My assistance at today's proceedings, Governor Spotswood's troop, for I am about to tell you a story. A story all the more remarkable because every word of it is true. That's right, every word. How do I know? Because I lived it, dear ones. Gentle boys and girls, kind men and ladies, the amazing adventures of Louis de Rougemont, as told by himself. Chapter 1, in which the seeds of adventure are sown. In the year 1860, I am a sickly child of 8. A pale and pasty-faced boy prone to coughs and sneezes. While other little children frolic in the outdoors, I am confined to my little bed in my little blue room.
Read around the rosy, pocket full of toesy, ashes, ashes, we all fall down.
Why must I stay indoors? Why can't I go out and play?
Dear child, you're a fragile boy with a delicate constitution. Best stay indoors, darling boy, where mother can protect you.
My devoted mother is there always at my bedside. She is there at night to tuck me in and blow out the lamp. She is there in the morning to let the sunlight wash over me.
Hello, dearest.
Mother reads to me.
After you've grown about a league and a half,
books break down the walls of my infirmary prison.
Who raised you? Melted me. Came wrong astern and took us with such a force and overset the boat at once.
Years go by. I outgrow childish things. My sickbed days have come to an end.
Louis, what on earth are you doing?
Listen to me, Mother. I've made up my mind. I'm leaving home. She does not take this well.
How long will you be gone?
However long it takes a young man to find his way in the world.
Take this.
The plays of Mr. William Shakespeare.
Everything you will ever need to know about life is between those covers.
Thank you.
The world's a dangerous place!
Oh, that may be so, but it's also marvelous. And so I enter the real world. There she is, the Wonder World. My, she's a beauty. once I find my sea legs, the journey looks so much brighter. We catch bluefish and snapper and fry them and eat together. All of us, the captain, the crew, Bruno, and me, we sing like children.
Thank you.
Mr. William Shakespeare. I set out in the sun to dry. Then, mysterious, glistening objects begin to wash ashore.
Whatever can they be, jellyfish?
Why, they're pickle jars, untouched by catastrophe, filled with rare and precious pearls. The days pass, weeks turn into months, and months into seasons. Bruno and I become accustomed to our new home. We learn to recognize the sounds of the island. Owls. Waves. Trumpets. The sky fills with stars. We studied stars and constellations. Look, Bruno. Cassiopeia. We wait out storms, huddled together in a cave. For amusement, I practice my acrobatics. High jumps. Cartwheels. Somersaults. When I'm not honing my acrobatics, I play with my new friends, the giant sea turtles. I sit atop their gnarly shell as I would upon a horse's saddle, and we glide through the water. I devise a method of steering that consists of a gentle poke in the eye. If I want my turtle to turn right, I poke my left toe into its left eye. If I wish to go left, I'll poke the right. Finally, one day, oh my God, something's out there. Some kind of boat. And it's floating toward our shore. Inside lay three people, an old man, a young woman, and a boy. Aborigines. But now here, dear audience, is where my saga takes an unexpected turn, for I am not rescued. Instead, I am handed a different role, but that of rescuer. Chapter 6, in which my isolation ends. My visitors are weak from their exposure to the elements. The young woman is the first to revive. I greet her with a reassuring smile. Hello. Well, do not be afraid. I am a man of peace. I have best to win their trust. My display of acrobatics. I run through my acrobatic repertoire 2, 3, 4 times until I drop from exhaustion. The young woman heals and offers me water. A simple gesture of kindness begins to form a helpful bond. I am Louie. What is your name?
Yamba.
Yamba.
Louie. Louie?
Yes, that is correct. The old man she somehow conveys is her father.
Gunda.
Gunda. And the boy, her brother. Was to please. One night, Yama points to the sky and asks,
"Do you see that star?"
Her English is perfect by now. My display of acrobatics. This is a hollow exercise, for there is no doubt whom I wish to be my bride. Yamba, will you marry me? And thus begins my new life among the Aborigines. Chapter 8, in which time passes and things change. Yamba and I have a daughter together we call Lynch, and a year or so later we have another called Gladys, who Runo is very protective towards the girls. This is the sad part. The saddest part of my story you will hear. My beloved Runo, yes, my devoted canine friend, this point very old and very tired, goes to sleep one night and simply never wakes. To my adopted people, to my dear Blanche and sweet Gladys, and to the most precious one of all, Ayama. Chapter 9. In which I set out to west. I trek miles and miles a day through pitch dark night and scorching sun, with a single thought reverberating in my head. Home. A team of Australians prospecting for gold has camped here for the night. Food. There must be food.
What's this? sailed in 1869. I've been lost almost 30 years.
He's as mad as a hatter. Leave him.
No, please, sir, I beg of you. Take me with you!
All right. We'll get you as far as anything, and you can hop a freight back here.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. The following morning, I worked my passage on a steamship.
Aboard to London, England.
Chapter 10, Journey's End. After weeks at sea, the lighter day begins to burn through the thick morning mist. Then, presto, like a magician's handkerchief lifted to reveal a prize. It is England. I am home. Factories spew up coal dust and grime over every tree and cobblestone. Something inevitable and terrifying all the same. Something by the name of progress. I find my way to my mother's home as if I had last been there yesterday and not 10,000 yesterdays ago. There it is, just as I remember it. Mother.
Am I dead?
No, dear, you are not dead.
Are you a ghost? Have you come to take me to heaven?
No, it is I, Louis.
Where on earth have you been?
I tell her everything.
What a fascinating story. You must tell it to the world.
But how, Mother?
I know. Look at this.
Wide World Magazine. Our motto, truth is stranger than fiction. All right, Mother, I will. The editor is a Mr. Fitzgerald. I go talk to him. Mr. Fitzgerald.
Yes?
My name is Louis de Rougemont. I have the most extraordinary tale to tell.
You and everyone else.
Oh, sir, my story is truly amazing.
No doubt. Put it in writing.
And so for the next several days and nights, my story pours out.
Oh, this really is amazing stuff.
You like that?
I love it. It has a little bit of everything. Adventures. Romance. Suspense.
I'm going to publish it.
In 10 weekly installments starting next week.
Thank you, sir.
Now what it means is a smart title, one that grabs the audience by storm and doesn't let go.
Yes.
Let's think.
I got it.
Shipwrecked. The amazing adventures of Louis de Rougemont as told by himself.
Perfect.
Wide world, get your wide world. Truth is stranger than fiction. Shipwrecked survived 30 years in the outback. Read all about it.
Give me one of those.
The talk of the town. How do you do, sir?
Yes, sir, that is correct.
Forgive my impudence, sir, but I personally have caught and handled thousands of sea turtles in my day, and not once have I witnessed a turtle tolerant of being touched anywhere on his body.
Not true, sir, not true.
Your assertions are so preposterous, it causes question every single claim. You are fantastic, indeed, unbelievable tale.
He's not outrageous!
Hope now, and hold, Sebastian, the world's foremost expert on novels. You say a shipment of yours for victim to a giant octopus?
Yes, sir, quite horrific it was, too.
I must say, in my 25 years of nautical experience in the Pacific, never have I seen such nautical.
No, why?
Please our sentiment. London Zoo, the world's leading authority on the wombat and all things wombat. The wombat is a burrowing animal, and yet Monsieur de Rougemont claims to have seen them, and I quote, rising through the clouds. As if they were winged creatures.
Clearly what I meant was flying squirrels.
And how is it possible to confuse a wombat and a flying squirrel? It simply isn't possible.
They're two different animals.
I was in error.
Excuse me, sir. Please point on the map shown behind you. Show us the exact location of the pearl we say you met.
My memory is not what it once was.
That's so. Why should you believe anything you have to say?
Exactly. Orders are dispatched to uncover whatever libelous filth they can get their dirty hands on.
Truth is indeed stranger than fiction.
His mentally unbalanced mother threw him out.
My mother was a saint.
Now you may have embarked on a whirling expedition.
Aha!
Said gentleman was marooned on a tiny island off the
coast. There you go.
However, he could not have gone missing more than 3 years.
3 years.
The madman was brought to Sydney where he later married. That's him, all right. He walked out on us that no good rock.
He has been two daughters, yet Blanche and Gladys.
The man who calls himself de Rougemont deserted his wife and daughters in Sydney and returned to London.
He spent countless hours in the British Library concocting his fantastic story.
That's me and their call. He had a particular fascination with the Aborigine. De Rougemont, oh, the 3 years was unaccounted for, and simply had been zero to
truth. What is truth? Can one hold it? Is it rock? Is it bone? If I am guilty of anything, it is of dabbing a few spots of color on the drab canvas of life.
Get your daily chronicle, as de Rougemont exposes the fraud. Paper, mister?
Thanks.
The man's a fool.
Which is the bigger fool, is he or are we to believe in him?
Time goes by. I am old now. I have but one amazing adventure yet to come, the adventure that all the living things must take. Before I bid you farewell, I wish to make here and now one last attempt to restore my good name. Gentle ladies and kind men, behold, a tank of water. This decrepit laughing stock will now mount and ride a giant sea turtle. Impossible, you say. A man cannot ride a turtle for his amusement. Oh, do you snicker, sir? At what the spectacle of a ridiculous old man? You absurd.